Thank you very much. So, and this place, as he says, Gaba is the leader. I knew Gaba from the first time he came here many years ago, together with a friend of mine, John. Some of you know John. John, the first time they came here, they came together. Gaba has been running this place. Before that, he was in Helsingør International People's College as the assistant principal there, and later on acting principal there. So when I asked him about if you want to host this event, he welcomed it. So for those of you who are our guests here, this is Khalifa Sada, Honorable Khalifa Sada. He's one of the opposition leaders who came together in the coalition and facilitated the defeat of ex-president Yahya Jammeh. And he's on a tour. He has been to Norway. And Khalifa has already been in Oslo and has been to Sweden. Now he visited us in Denmark. This is the first event, and we say welcome to you. Today, the topic is going to be the new Gambia, aftermath of a dictator. We ask Khalifa to talk about that. And also, you have had the introduction and the topic about dialogue. So if you can talk about that, then we can start a debate here if people have questions to ask. So, welcome.
Thank you very much. This is the beginning of the program. Tomorrow is the big day. And I believe what we have heard confirms that this is a bigger day. Humankind is on the march towards a destiny of liberty, dignity, and prosperity for all. It is then that we would have arrived at the gate of civilization. As long as any human being is deprived of liberty, dignity, and prosperity, we are yet to live there. Civilization does not drop from the sky. In order to build it, we must become thinkers. We must become creators, inventors, before we can become builders. And the chairperson says, let's stop shouting, whining, and wailing. Let us talk. And that's what makes human beings human beings. The capacity to be two people at the same time. To be a person and a social being. And the person can be given any characteristics. You can give the person a characteristic of a race or an ethnolinguistic group or a religion or a gender. You can give the person any attribute. But that attribute could also end up defining the person. And that's why you have the borders. So how do we break those borders and make the human being a human being? Universal in conception of reality, universal in behavior, in order to create the world. That is the challenge before humanity, that is the challenge before the Gambian people. Gambia has changed forever. It will never be the same again. For 52 years, we are told that we are an independent nation. When we talk about independent nation, we are talking about nationality. We're talking about national borders. Within those national borders, if we cannot be united, how can we be united with the other people of the world? Even West Africa, Africa, and farther afield, humanity at large. So the starting point is the type of social being who would be able to unite with others to build a nation without becoming so narrow nationalistic that we exclude ourselves from the rest of West Africa, Africa, and the farther afield of the world. How do we unite within borders in order to go beyond borders to unite to build a world of peace and prosperity? A world where everybody will be secure. It is important for every Gambian to also accept that we have a duty to humanity if we really want a world of peace. Our duty is to begin internally to unite, to start talking, sharing ideas, in order to create a social being that is in harmony with self and others, that we call citizens. The geopolitical entity that we now call the Gambia, if you look at the map, had a history. When did it come into being? Every Gambian should know. Why do we call ourselves Gambians? You should know. That geopolitical entity, the borders that we are to cross, but before crossing, you have to unite internally first. That geopolitical entity was drawn on the 10th of August 1889 by an agreement between the British and the French Republic to create a Gambian colony, so that France will take the other side and the internal part will be taken by the United Kingdom. Even though those who settled within that geopolitical entity did not agree that outsiders owned that territory, they had to fight all those who resisted until they could suppress them. And by 1902, they came up with the Protectorate Ordinance, which established Gambia as a colony. So as a result, by 1902, You had a governor owing allegiance to the British crown, and the territory was divided into divisions, governed by regional commissioners owing allegiance to the governor. And the divisions were divided into districts, administered by chiefs, sefos, who owed their allegiance to the commissioners and the governor. And each district divided into villages, headed by headmen called Algarum, who owed their allegiance to the chiefs, to the commissioners, and the governor. Gambian people were not a people. They were subjects. They had to owe allegiance, obedience, adherence to a foreign power, the United Kingdom, the Queen of the United Kingdom, or the King of the United Kingdom, whoever was the monarch. So consequently, an administration was established with needed resources. So they had to impose import duties and pass on the cost to the population who bought the goods. All those goods that were imported, when they passed the customs, would pay the duties. And the businesses that bought the goods would sell the goods with addition of the duties paid. So the people were paying taxes without knowing. They had direct and indirect taxes, but they had no representation. The resources were meant to build schools, hospitals, infrastructure, so that the people will be able to have decent lives. But that was not the mission of those who controlled the Gambia at the time. Education was not a priority. And it was meant only to produce the clerks who would be able to run the colonial administration and the little services they could provide in terms of health. As a result, the nationals of the country who happened to have some form of literacy were able to read further afield, influenced by a movement all over Africa and the world for the right to self-determination and independence. They captured the essence of what independence meant, and they coined the clarion call, no taxation without representation. Those who pay taxes own the money. They should entrust it to someone who will utilize it to render services to them. And that someone must be selected by them, so that if there is misappropriation of those funds, they will be able to remove that person and replace that person with such other person who will be able to deliver the services they need. That is what representation is all about. That is the core of democracy. Consequently, they began to demand the right to self-rule, self-determination, and independence. Self-rule started with the councils, eventually to make the history short, by 1965, we are told that we became independent. But in reality, we attained the right to self-determination. But we had not reached the level of being truly independent. We were on the march to independence. Why? Because we still had a governor general who constituted the executive, owing allegiance, obedience, and adherence to the crown, who was resident still at Government House. It was on the 24th of April, 1970, when Gambia became a republic. The Governor General disappeared, and executive power resided in the president of the country. But who taught us that? That day is not even celebrated in the Gambia. And that is the beginning of the emergence of the sovereign people of the Gambia. On that day, each Gambian became the depository of the sovereignty of the land. And if from that day, each Gambian was educated to know that power belongs to him or her, and that representatives were only public trustees, occasionally selected to be entrusted with the power to collect money from us and use it to render services to us, then we would have had the collective awareness and identity as Gambians. Because we know that our interests would not be contradicted to the order to have an executive, a national assembly member, a parliamentarian, whose role is to utilize resources for our benefit, laws for our benefit, so that we can live in liberty and prosperity. The failure to help us to have that consciousness gave rise to the existence of a sovereign republic without a sovereign people. As a result, our personal identities began to matter. Our identity in terms of ethno-linguistic group, our identity in terms of religion, our identity in terms of gender, our identity in terms of where we originate from, what part of the country. And if that is also transformed into a political identity, then you have the borders. Based on ethnicity, based on religion, based on gender, based on place of origin, and it goes on and on, class and all. So the beginning of a nation required that we have a political identity of citizenship, so that all of us will respect each other, that we belong to the nation, and that the nation, when we come to select its leaders to serve us, we do not put our different identities up front. Not the ethno-linguistic identity, not the religious identity, not the gender identity, not where we originated from. You cannot put that up front and still have a nation. Once you put that up front, then the nation is divided. And a nation divided can never be strong to stand, to develop, to guarantee our people liberty, dignity, and prosperity. For 52 years, that country never changed to the ballot box. 30 years, a coup d'etat in 1994, another 22 years, until 2016, that we began a new journey. That's why I am here, for us to understand what happened and to know where we are to go from here. Twenty-two years, those who carried out the coup d'etat conceived Gambia as their private property because they believed that if they did not carry out the coup d'etat, change would have never occurred. And the mass of the population believed that because they had never assumed responsibility of effecting change based on their concept. They never believed in themselves. They never knew who they were. They did not know the power of their vote. They did not know that that vote served as power to say how Gambia would be governed. They never saw the need to unite. It was an atom facing the person who seek office as individuals, not as social being, of being the Gambian citizen who should determine how Gambia will be transformed in a country that will guarantee Gambians liberty, dignity, and prosperity. If everybody thought that way, then we'll be united in thinking, because it will be thinking, you who want to take over, what do you have to offer? And if it is convincing, you convince the others, and you know precisely why you are voting for Sauk. And therefore, if that person fails to deliver, you'll be able to uproot that person without any hesitation. If people aware and organized become powerful, if people ignorant and disorganized become weak. Because of our ignorance, because we were disorganized for 22 years, we were weak. So consequently, governance was abused, misrule entrenched, impunity entrenched. Most Gambians felt that change will never come to the barrack. Many were waiting for something to come, something imaginary, someday, and save them, not knowing that it was within their powers to save themselves. Few months before the 2016 presidential election, many Gambians, 99.9%, maybe more than that, could not conceive that Gambia could be changed peacefully through the barrack box. Many were hoping for the country to be like what happened in Libya, what happened in Egypt, that there will be a Gambian spring, and that will get the self-perpetuating ruler to move away. But how to bring that about was the problem. And therefore, many people who lived hopeless existence began to blame the opposition, that the opposition was weak. It should go in the street. It was weak. It is going in the street. But the opposition is who? Few leaders or the people? It is the people with their might who can change governments, either through the ballot box or through any other means. But people whom you know would go to the people to give them bags of rice or something, to even get them to go and vote. You expect those people will be able to take those people in the street to do anything else? We did not create the people who knew what they owned and who would be ready to defend what they owned with all their might. So the issue of tactic became very clear. And the tactic was, as long as the people were disorganized, of course, state power was in the hands of the incumbent, police, security apparatus, NIA, jails. It could arrest and detain and subjugate. If you are frightened with that, you stay away. So what was the answer? The answer was, you also have the power of the people, which since 1970, 47 years ago, should have been consolidated so that no leader will ever have the daring mind to think that you can do anything that will suppress the people. It will not be part of the culture of a people, because each leader will know that your power originates from the people, and anytime they can remove you without hesitation. That culture wasn't there. So consequently, we had to move on the basis of tactic to consolidate the power of the people, which starts with awareness. To bring about that awareness, you must first have hope. When people do not have hope, they would not listen to the point of becoming aware of tactics and strategies. And that is why when six people were declared to be independent, to be presidential candidates or parties or independent candidate, I was a presidential candidate. I convened a meeting of all the presidential candidates so that we can select one among us to be the presidential candidate of the opposition so that our forces will not be divided. That was the beginning of giving hope to the people that if they galvanize around that personality, then change is possible. It's a long history. I'm not here to narrate a history, but to draw the lessons. Yes, we finally agreed that we will select one person who will stand as an independent candidate so that he will not represent, or she will not, at that time we didn't know who, and there was a woman. We said that person will not represent any political party so that the borders will begin to dissipate and we start to unite the people to start the building of a nation before we talk about dividing the parties again for the people to select on the basis of parties. We agreed on that first principle. The candidate must stand as an independent candidate to unify the opposition. Secondly, since our biggest problem was self-perpetuating rule, 30 years, 22 years, we said never again, that we will start with an example, that the person who is going to be selected will demonstrate that he has no hunger or she has no hunger for power. And to demonstrate that the person must agree not even to serve the term provided for by the Constitution, a 5-year term, but will serve 3 years, so that that person will not consolidate any power structure that would lead to self-perpetuation. And with that example, then the constitutional reforms will consolidate a 2-term limit, so that whoever comes again, out of the example given by the first, you will never have the daring mind to even talk about altering that constitutional provision when it is established. So we wanted to consolidate the culture of the sovereignty of the people so that leaders will begin to humble themselves as servants of the people, not as their lords. We agreed to those principles, fought the election, selected a candidate, had a convention, we all participating on an equal basis, even though we know they were unequal parties. But the objective was to not to put a party in power, but to give Gambia a new start, so that all will be in the same ground. If you're going to come again, rely on your program and strength in the future to seek the mandate of the people on the basis of your party program. And we believe everybody will be humbled to want change for all, not change for a particular group. We finally selected a presidential candidate. He stood as an independent candidate. During the campaign, the borders were there. The incumbent has insulted the largest ethno-linguistic group. They were responding. There was division on the basis of ethno-linguistic grouping. An Islamic State had been declared. The Christian community isolated. There was border on the basis of religion. And the society as a whole was fragmented into interest groups. The fundamental challenge was to bridge the borders and establish the consciousness of citizenship, sovereign citizenship, so that informed choice would be exercised by all those who wanted to move the country forward. And therefore, in the camp of the coalition, we had to break the borders and told who was supporting the coalition that as soon as you break those borders and insult another ethno-linguistic group, you are dividing us, and divided, the incumbent will remain in power. So let's adopt the clarion call, one Gambia, one nation, one people. One Gambia, one nation, one people. With the other countries will sound like a narrow nationalistic call, but every nation must evolve to be a nation first before you can break the borders of narrow nationalism to move into genuine internationalism. Either by bringing closeness at a West African level, at an African level, in terms of union, or an international level by meeting our obligation to the international community. As a result of that clarion call, those Gambians who wanted Gambia to have a new start became united into a solid bond, campaigned with enthusiasm. And by the end of the campaign, a mighty organized force was built, fully aware that the primary aim of regime change must be achieved to give Gambia a new start. And everybody who Rose believed in that, and consequently the change did come about to the balance. What was conceived impossible became possible, giving Gambians a new lesson that indeed, with awareness and organization, we can become free. We won the election. The incumbent accepted, which would have been also history. But eventually, in a week, he reneged his position. And Gambia was again face to the challenge of either war or peace. we decided to choose peace by leaving the incumbent to choose war, knowing that if the people are organized and aware, peace will be there. Consequently, constitution became relevant to the Gambian population. It was never relevant to them. They never knew what the purpose of a constitution was after 52 years of existence. But there they were told that it is the constitution that is the supreme law, that is what enabled us to win an election. It is that same constitution that must dictate when power will be assumed. And when that day occurs, then again, like one bond, the Gambian people must ensure that the verdict of the people and the constitution will be uninviolable. We calculated and we saw, for you people to understand, that under the constitution, elections to the office of president takes place within 3 months before the expiration of the term of the incumbent. And that will leave the incumbent with a residue of term left for the 5 years to be complete. We had to calculate that and fix it to be 18th January 2017, the end of his 5 year term. So we therefore said, let every Gambian wait for a day. Let them not be intimidated by anyone. Let them know that after the 18th, the incumbent will become a rebel. If he refuses to go, the military apparatus will also be apparatus of rebels if they support the incumbent, and on. So Gambians had to decide, those in the military, those who were ministers, those who were ambassadors, all had to make a decision, take a stand. To be rebels or to be Gambian citizens who would accept the verdict of the people and the verdict of the constitution. Well, fortunately for us, a reconciliation started then with the Gambian military, Gambian security apparatus making a commitment that they will not be on the side of the incumbent when the day comes for him to go according to the verdict of the constitution. That was the first architecture for peace, for the transition of the country. Therefore, we must tell the whole world that working in a military apparatus, security apparatus, should not alienate you from the people, because out of the wealth of the people, you are paid, you live. So whenever the people make their decision and the constitution makes a decision, you should obey. That is one ground rule for peaceful transfer of power. That is why on the 19th, President Barrow assumes office. And on the 19th, the Gambia had changed whilst the incumbent refused to go. But it had changed because his ministers, his ambassadors, his military apparatus, security apparatus, all had abandoned him. And the Gambian citizen, irrespective of those who supported him in terms of political affiliation, wanted peace, because they also know that they will not survive the war. So as a result, all Gambians decided to stay home. And therefore, the incumbent could only rule shadows but not human beings. And shadows do not have material power to protect anyone. So as as a result, through negotiation, he decided to leave. And on the 21st of July, the change became real. Was there any looting in the Gambia? No. Did they tear files in the government departments and public enterprises? No. So transition is also very fundamental. And what happened in the Gambia is unique. Even in areas where elections take place, here and there, you will see people killing each other, or tearing files, or going into public establishments, you know, to start scrambling to steal. But here, everything was intact. And that is why, if you follow cyberspace, some are saying that some people say that Jam has stolen this type of money. Listen very carefully, you Gambians. Listen very carefully. The transition was such that the Inspector of General Police visited all the establishments of the country and spoke to the people who were in authority, and they said all the papers, everything was intact. That country is saved. Because no matter what you do inside, once you do your auditing, you will discover what has happened there, and you know who is going to be accountable. That is how you ensure accountability in a country. But once you start announcing that something has been stolen and you did not secure those places, of course, new looters can come, who can hit all the things to others when they themselves will end up doing something that is wrong. That is why the transition in the Gambia is unique in every respect. And as a result, you should learn the lesson. Because what you've asked me is, what is the way forward? The way forward is very clear. President Barrow returned with tens of thousands of people welcoming him. That is Gambia's achievement. If there was war, with people struggling whether Gambia has this money or that money, we will not be talking about Gambia today. Some people find it very convenient now to talk about the Gambia and what should have been done. But the most important thing at that time was for Gambia to go and Barrow to come into office. And that has been achieved. And if there was hesitated to come. So if there were any skirmishes, any breakdown of order would have been delayed. So we have achieved a peaceful transition. What is the way forward? All institutions intact. It is the President Barrow, after assuming office, who has obligation to exercise executive power. And his task is to appoint ministers and give them the responsibility to manage ministries. And those ministers will be the spokesperson of the government for the ministries under them. And it is their duty to come up with strategic plans for their ministries, programs and projects in order to provide services to the Gambian population. That is his primary task. It is also his primary task to look into the government that he had removed from office. It is for him to decide how to handle that particular government. Is he going to involve himself in transitional justice to try to recover all the wrongs, to find out all the wrongdoings of that government and try to recover whatever that government has misappropriated? That is for the Barrow administration to come to a decision about. What had happened prior to his assumption of office is the involvement of ECOWAS, involvement of United Nations, involvement of AU. So it is for him to meet those people, show them exactly how he intended to move so that they reach an understanding with him in terms of what this transition is going to come about, what it is going to lead. And you have two transitions to address. One is the transition of administration. You have public enterprises, you have government departments that must be inherited by the new government. The first task would have been for all the enterprises to go through an auditing system, so that everything that is there will be known. Whatever is missing will be known. That should have been the starting point of the whole process. So in that regard, you have audited reports and to decide whether there is something worth pursuing or is not worth pursuing. That's left to each government to decide. That was the starting point. The second point is the former president. How do you relate to him? What do you do with him? That's your duty to decide exactly. Out of the reports of the auditor reports, you will be able to determine who is responsible for what and what you are to do. Let me just give you an example. Social Security is a key ministry. It's a key public enterprise. The bulk of resources comes from the working people of the government. 400 million was taken to establish by Ocean Bay and refurbish it, to buy another hotel, the AU villas. So that public enterprise has even shares in the trust bank. So you are talking about billions. You're not talking about tens of millions. You are talking about billions of a public enterprise. And you need to know exactly what the government owns. And with that public enterprise, you'll be able to know what government owns. Now, the issue of the former president is left to you to decide whether you want to negotiate to get certain things from him, you want to accommodate, that is left to you as a president. Or you're going to take other actions to make sure that he pays for impunity, he pays for resources that have disappeared. It's left to you. It's a negotiation and compromise that you make, or you take a firm stand, depending what is in the interest of your nation, what is in the interest of stability. That's what transitional justice is all about. So essentially, the way forward is to be able to identify the wealth of the nation. Gamsa, what is its wealth? You need to identify all of this for Gambia to be able to have good start, because if the public corporation do not pay a dividend to government, you are going to depend on taxes. So you just politicize everything, but at the end of the day, the people will pay more taxes and their living conditions will not improve. If the living conditions of the people will improve, sovereign national wealth must be identified, and that's the public corporation. They need to be audited. Performance contracts signed with them so that you know that dividend will be paid to the national cause. That is the way forward. Now, in terms of transitional justice, those who have killed people, those who have disappeared without trace, those who have tortured, well, that's how you establish transitional justice. And of course, already a bill is being looked into to see exactly what the transitional justice will be all about. But in South Africa and everywhere, each government must come to a decision to see whether certain actions are worth taking or certain actions will make you live in the past rather than you move into the future. I am sure as the bill comes to the National Assembly, you will hear my voice analyzing it to see what is in the best interest of the country under the circumstances. But transitional justice must have four fundamental pillars. One, it must be substantive justice, so that you know that investigation is done properly to identify a person who has done wrong and the person who is a victim. Or if the victim is dead, those who are next of kin of the victim. All must be satisfied that the act is known and the culprit is also known. Transitional justice must also be curative. Must come to a point where what is done will make the person who is a victim feel satisfied that the action taken is the right action. And the person who has perpetrated will be satisfied that yes, I did it, but the way I am tried is free and fair. That it has made me to see my mistake, and if I am to suffer penalties, yes, you know, I should suffer the penalty. It should also be rehabilitative. It must go beyond revenge. It must make the person to know that now I can live, I can heal, I can be a new person. I can even forgive the person, even after penalties and suffering of penalties. I no longer look at the person as my enemy. And it must be restorative. It must make the person to go and live normal life. If there is need for compensation, compensate the individual. Even government can participate in compensating if the perpetrator does not have the means to compensate. But we must make that person to have a new start. So all those elements will be looked at in any commission that is established, and the methods that will be utilized, and the outcome that will be received. So it is important then to see that these are the ways that government can help to move the country forward. But what must be borne in mind is that the new Gambia cannot move forward unless we leave the government to do its work, whilst the population begin their own work. But if the population concentrate on the work of government, politicize that, the division in society will continue. If it is done in a proper manner, all people will be observers of the process and will be happy with outcomes. But if it is politicized, obviously there will be division in society. And to bring about a new Gambia will be a difficulty. So it means that the population must begin their own work of reconciliation. We emphasize, and you are hearing people mentioning it everywhere, that we must overcome the barriers, the borders of ethno-linguistic barriers, religious barriers, gender barriers, and go back to citizenship and our rights as citizens to be one in order to shape our destiny. If that is to come about, then Gambian people must become organized to build a movement, non-partisan movement, non-religious movement, a civic movement for one Gambia, one nation, one people. To educate each other that irrespective of our party affiliations, we have two caps. The cap of a party politically and the cap of a citizen. The cap of a citizen requires all of us to understand our constitution, to understand our rights, to monitor the work of government together, criticize what is wrong, expose any impunity, prevent a reoccurrence of the past, ensure good governance, the rule of law, respect for fundamental rights and freedom, and ensure that that country will not sink again to what it was in the past, a regime of impunity, a regime of prisoners, a regime of people just following without asking questions. So a new Gambian must be born if we are to have a new Gambia. And that new Gambian can only be born if we start to talk to each other to understand how our nation should be governed, its instruments, its institutions, and ensure that those instruments and institutions are built. And that is the last phase of my deliberation. To build a new Gambia, we need to work together to reform our constitution. The constitution gives executive power, monarchical powers, where the president appoints ministers and removes ministers without any explanation. That was the situation in our 1970 constitution. That is the situation in the 1997 constitution. But if we are to build a new Gambia, we must come with a new constitution where the checks and balances will be instituted in order for us to build a better society than we have inherited. It means that the National Assembly Parliament must now be empowered. If you appoint an ambassador, if you appoint a minister, they will appear before the National Assembly at least for a review of their credentials before confirmation. That will give us better checks and balance system to avoid people moving into the past. Our constitution does not have a term limit. That was also the case in the 1970 constitution. That's why the first republic lasted for 30 years, the second 32 years. We need to establish a term limit of 2 years. The debate should be whether it's 4-year term or 5-year term. It's left to Gambians to debate. For me, why 5 years? Well, Obama, 4 years. And he was there for 8 years. It appears that he's been there for centuries. In Nigeria, it's 4 years now. Why 5 years in the Gambia? So if I had my choice, I would say a citizen demand for 4 years term. Of 2 years, of two terms. In the constitution now, if the president, something happens, who will be the president of the country? The vice president is to stay for the rest of the term of the president. But at the moment, we have someone overseeing the vice president, not somebody sworn to the vice president. So it means that the speaker of the National Assembly, if there is no vice president, will be the president of the country for the rest of the term. Under the 1970 constitution, the Gambia Opposition for Electoral Reform has observed we had a provision there which should be imported in our current constitution, which says that should the office of president becomes vacant, the vice president should assume office. For less than 90 days, you have election within those 90 days to the office of president. That is what should be there. If that was there, nobody would also ask the question. It's not in the constitution to say that the President Barrow will only be there for 3 years. Of course, that's a gentle person's agreement. It's just a demonstration of moral will, political will, to defeat self-perpetuating rule. So if that provision was in the constitution, after 3 years you would just resign, and within 3 months you have election to the presidency. That's left to President Barrow to decide. The objective is clear, to put an end to self-perpetuating rule. So there is need for constitutional reforms. And it is important that before at least the end of this year, a constitutional package should come to the National Assembly as the first phase of transforming the Constitution of the Republic to consolidate the sovereignty of the people. To say, let's wait for a long debate, we want to, in fact, reform, revise the whole Constitution, that is called delay. And as people get entrenched in power, many things will become impossible. So what is necessary now, at least the basics, let's agree on the basics and reform the basics. Then all the reviews for a character constitution can come later. But the basics, just like 65 years, came to power. Why not the whole package? We constitute the audiences. If you can bring 65 years to power, why not the time then, etc. So it is important that we become focused and ensure that we come up with constitutional reform, electoral reform. I'm asked, how will the diaspora participate in the whole process? Well, of course, the diaspora can demand in that constitutional reform, because if you have dual citizenship, you cannot be a minister, you cannot be a president. If you've been away for 5 years, you cannot come and stand as a presidential candidate. So essentially, the diaspora can demand for those constitutional reform. That we as citizens, we don't believe that not anything happens to us other than love of country if we are away in search of greener pastures. That's left to the diaspora to demand for those reforms to participate. But one thing that does not even need reform is that enfranchisement of the diaspora. Because the diaspora, according to the constitution and the electoral laws, is supposed to vote. And the opposition, when we were in the opposition, did agree to ensure that the diaspora is enfranchised. We demanded that from them. Obviously, now it's our duty to ensure that that happens. So these are the constitutional issues that could be handled. But we must also move into institutional reform. We must demand that all the public enterprises would be monitored to be able to pay dividend to the country, because it's a source of sovereign national wealth. But if we come to a point where we do not handle those enterprises properly, we'll end up selling all of them, and therefore will depend entirely on taxation to bring about development. That is a difficult task. I personally do not envisage seeing any country develop to meet the needs of the people just on the basis of taxation. There must be a productive state, public sector, complemented by a productive private sector, cooperative sector, and informal sector. That creates the basis of a transitional economy that can provide you with the services that you need. Without that, the services will not improve to our expectation. Salaries will not be improved to our expectation. Developed jobs will not be improved to our expectation. So it is important for us to look at economic policy. My conclusion, if we expect that by just giving fishing licenses to industrial fishing companies, and they pay license and then fish ad infinitum and take it away, that is not the way that Gambia will be able to develop, to provide jobs to its citizens. I've been to Norway. Norway was a fishing nation before it became an oil-producing nation. We have that mighty ocean. If we ensure that the companies that are given licenses as a matter of pride will be landing their fish in Gambia, will provide the basis of employment to our citizens, and exporting it will bring foreign exchange, and therefore our foreign reserves will not only depend on grants and loans, but it will depend on what we sell, what we export. That is absolutely essential. It is important also for Gambians not to be copycats. Here and there you hear people who have been abroad somewhere, yes, in America elsewhere, 3% of the population are engaged in agriculture. They produce everything that that country needs. So that's what we need to do in the Gambia. But in those countries, they went through a process of industrialization, where industries and services expanded. And therefore, many people who moved from the rural areas were able to find jobs in the urban areas. That's what gave rise to urbanization. And therefore, jobs could be provided. So few people with machinery can engage in agriculture. But in a country which is an agrarian, where 70% of the population depend on agriculture, if you wipe out those population and give only to 3% of farmers, clearly those people will starve in the urban areas without means of survival. So the solution to our agriculture is being able to give seeds, fertilizer, and farming implements to a cooperative banking system to the family farms which still exist, so that they can increase their production and their earning capacity and be able to live better lives. The same thing with our women guides. They must be given seed, fertilizer, and all implements they need to work on their garden and have a marketing unit that will come and buy their vegetables from their gardens and go and process them anyhow, some for export, some for retail. That is how you can help them to increase production and not to go into the markets and start selling and cannot sell and then it spoils and therefore run themselves, ground themselves into poverty. So therefore, the task is grand. Gambia has minerals. Year after year we have exposed. During the campaign you hear, you heard me say, Sanya Batokunku Kato is incumbent at the time, and Jamia who is removed used to mine, and they were mining, and nobody knew where it went. It is important now to look at the geology unit, let it reveal everything that is there, what has been found, so that we know whether is diamond in Tumana, what is there, what is in Kato. All this need to be immediately discovered and transformed into means of giving the country sovereign national wealth. This is the urgency. You see people build this, there's a commission of inquiry, it's looking for that. Fine. Nobody says, don't do what you ought to do. But what is important, what should be done now? And I'm emphasizing, and I hope Gambians are listening, we need sovereign national wealth to be able to defeat poverty. To get sovereign national wealth, public enterprises must be put on a footing where they will be able to deliver sovereign national wealth. The minerals of the country, whatever, should be known, and the geology unit should be able to tell us what has been discovered, what has been found, and how it has been managed. Those are urgencies. Once we discover that, we can start right now building up the relationships so that they can earn the country the type of foreign exchange that we need and the sovereign national wealth that we need. Those are the priorities. So therefore, the economy is a priority, and we can move into processing of our fruits, of our vegetables, of our oil. I have emphasized, we've emphasized it during the campaign, that Gambia needs 200,000 tons of rice. We are producing 57,000 tons. The latest figures I had, 2015 figures. But if we can produce 200,000 tons, we are putting 1.9 billion into our national coffers. If we can produce 140,000 tons more, we can put 1.9 billion in our national coffers into Gambian GDP. The same thing with oil. We are importing over 600 million worth of vegetable oil. We can produce that oil because we are producing groundnuts, process it. And that oil will be able to deliver 600 million into our GDP. So in essence, this is what we need with immediacy to work on so that the country can start moving. And you in the diaspora, I've told many of the leaders I have met that they must understand why you are here. It's not because Gambia is poor, it's because Gambia has been impoverished by poor leadership. It's the poverty of our leadership, poverty of our policies, which has led to poverty of our people. So consequently, 60% of the people live in the rural areas, while 40 people live in the urban areas. Over 67% of the population are less than 35. This is the active population. Yet, where are the industries? Where are the services for people to get employed? And that's why you have the push factor for people to leave Gambia in search of greener pastures elsewhere. So now Europe is establishing frontiers because everybody knows not everybody can come and find work in Europe. That is known. But what is the solution? If you have a roadmap, you not only look at people moving, you also look at capital moving, profit moving, goods moving. If we do not develop to be able to produce what Europe would need, and they also sell us what we need, how can you promote international trade? And if we become poor and are unable to consume, how will Europe sell its technology and its goods? Well, obviously, to put frontiers of security where you invest billions will not lead to a safer world, will not lead to a win-win situation. Rather, it will lead to a very poor world where you have a world depression. So in my district, I'm also cautioning the whole international community to see the trends of how the migration crisis is being handled. If it is handled in a militaristic way, billions will be spent on security and building the security apparatus rather than on human beings and products. So therefore, it is necessary to revisit. First, to know that those countries are not necessarily antagonistic to Europe's development because they are a source of profit. They are a source of people buying goods that come and technology that come from Europe to ensure Europe's prosperity. And I have no doubt that if you do a cost-benefit analysis of profit that is coming from that part of the world, in terms of trade, etc., Europe will not be short-changed in that relationship. So in that sense, then, clarity must be given to the citizens of Europe to bridge these borders that you are talking about. Because it starts with the chaining of the mind. It starts with ignorance, lack of understanding of the world. But I have no doubt that if what is put in this security apparatus is intelligently prepared for investment into small and medium-sized enterprises, giving to the youth who would have searched for greener pastures elsewhere, and they start processing and selling in the supermarkets what Europeans consume. Productive base will enhance. Those people will not think of coming to Europe. Their development will be assured as they wait for the countries to come up with grander policies of more processing, more industrialization, of a different form, learning, of course, from Europe, but dirty industries, in order to ensure that jobs are granted to more and more people. It is absolutely essential for that message to be understood. And for our people to also have hope that with our collective intelligence, we can be the architects of a destiny that can guarantee us the prosperity that we seek. So in short, your message is very clear. This is a time to talk. It's time for dialogue. It is time to exchange opinions on the way forward. And that was the objective of our coalition. That no party or person seeks to gain, but to build a Gambia for all. So that in the National Assembly, we will not stand as parties. In the country, we will not stand as parties. We will stand as independent coalition candidates so that we all galvanize and build a country and give Gambia a new start. Since that has not happened, you, the people, must ensure that we do not go off track. The parties can seek their support base. There's nothing wrong to belong to a party and wear a party hat. But that should not prevent you from wearing a hat of a citizen, and therefore wear the hat of a citizen, where you want all of us to unite, irrespective of our ethno-linguistic origin, our religion, our gender, but still belong to the parties of our choice and promote the programs of our choice. But let's be together as a start, so that we also know that we must become internationalists. The problem of humanity in any West African country, in any African country, in the world as a whole, should be our concern as a people. So if we develop those values, those democratic, republican, and internationalist values, we will be human beings who will be bridging the frontiers and rather than create the gap that will ultimately lead all of us into the abyss of tyranny and poverty. Together, we can build a new Gambia. Together, we can build a new world. But that is inconceivable until we use our brain to think, until we accept the values of democracy, of people-centered development, of internationalism. Then and only then could we become the architects of our destiny. Thank you.
I was waiting for Mamadou, but I think he was handed over silently.
I handed over to you. Yes.
Oh.
questions or a small break.
Oh, thanks a lot, our guest of honor. I normally lose track of speeches. But every single second, I have navigated your speech, and it's a pleasure for me to have been part of it and have heard what you said. Ladies and gentlemen, we will take a break, a short break, replenish ourselves. There is a table out there, but I want to introduce. Gentleman that came in not long ago. He's the youngest, one of the youngest in this room. Please welcome to Gaba Diallo, my boss and the director, the founder of Crossing Borders. And I will request that you move over and give company to the honorable. He's really lonely.
I think maybe we just do that after the break.
Okay.
I think it's the time of him, right? So I think we good to meet you.
No, it's a break time.
It's a break time.
Let's have a.